Hey, what's happening? So listen, you know me by now, Paul Machin, massive Liverpool fan. You may not know, bit of a wrestling geek as well for me sins. So when I saw that WWE through the NXT UK brand are pushing a guy claiming to be Liverpool's number one, wearing a live bird on his trunks and using a finisher called Shankly Gates, I think it's fair to say my interest was piqued. So today I'm on the way to Anfield to do the lap with wrestler Zach Gibson. Zach Gibson, Liverpool's number one.
I mean, soon to be recognised as the world's number
soon
one.
Soon to be recognised. Obviously, you're from Liverpool, you're a Liverpool fan. What are your sort of earliest memories of being a Liverpool fan coming to Anfield?
Like most lads, I guess, you kind of get into the team that your dad's into.
Yeah.
And then a couple of years down the line, if your dad's made an awful ricket and made you support Chelsea, then you just change. But luckily, my dad is a Red. So
it was never an issue.
No, it wasn't an issue. He got me into footy when I was younger.
Yeah.
And like, he tried to, you know, he forced me into a Sunday league team playing for the local school. I say forced, it was always fun.
Yeah.
He used to take me down to the game. Unfortunately, not the copper. Normally, he likes the main stand. He always has done.
Yeah.
Personal preference, I guess, yeah. As far as like first memories of the club, I wouldn't necessarily say it was even a particular game. It was more the 2001 season.
Yeah.
Won the treble.
Yeah.
And then he took us down, Joe brought us down into the streets to come and watch them on the parade, bring it all back. So that's the one that sticks with me.
Well, it's a pretty decent place to start, I guess, really, exactly. when you think about it. And in terms of kits, what was your first Liverpool kit?
Well, saying that, I had the ones when you're a kid. You don't really get a choice, do you? They just sort of plonk you in one. There is actually a picture somewhere where, against my will, my uncle stuck me in an Everton kit and tried to get that, and he still tries to bring it up to this day, especially with what I do now.
What is it with uncles in that regard? I had an uncle who's a Man United fan, just to clarify, not by blood, married into the family. My Uncle Simon, love you. Man United fan, and he was constantly trying to get me to support United, trying to get me to stick Man United stickers in my dad's car and all that kind of stuff. Uncles have got that quality, haven't they?
But he just didn't make a very convincing argument every time he's tried to get me into it. Like,
why didn't you come? Blue's a nice colour.
Why don't you come down to the pub and be miserable with all of us?
Stadiums are much better made out of wood than metal and plastic.
I'll pass, mate.
Yeah,
I'll pass.
I know. I've swerved that one.
But I'd say my favourite kit, it was the Carlsberg kit. So yeah. Any different one. I actually did a parody of it for myself.
Well, yeah, you've got
a couple of years later, the
Gibson stuff.
And the yellow kit. I've always been a sucker for the yellow kit.
Really?
Yeah, I don't know why.
What is it? So, I mean, It's funny because you look at you now, and we'll talk about the character creation and what have you. Liverpool is so much at the core of what you do, and it always struck me as odd that Liverpool doesn't have more of a presence, I guess. You know, you see it in football. You know, there's world-renowned footballers from Liverpool, and you see, you know, actors and all that kind of stuff. I always wondered why you never really seen it, but you've totally. Is it that there are and people don't embrace it, or what? I don't know, because you do seem, you've so actively embraced it. You've got the live bird stuff, you've got, you know what I mean, Scout style, all that kind of thing.
I guess it's probably a mixture of the two. You know, there's definitely other talents from Liverpool, and like before me there was the Liverpool lads, Doc Dean, Robbie Brookside, Frankie Sloane then became one of the Liverpool lads, so they definitely embraced it. They just did it in their own way. When I first started wrestling, I was just so eager to wrestle. That was it. I just had my blinkers on. I just wanted to get about. I just wanted to wrestle and do my thing. And being super proud of from Liverpool wasn't really anything. It wasn't this, it wasn't that. It was just somewhere in the back of my head. It was only after training in Manchester for like 2 or 3 years and getting stick every single time I was there. And also just thinking, like, this city's rubbish. I hate being here.
Yeah.
And the more I travelled, basically, the more wrestling got me to travel, the more I realised how much I missed this city and how much I missed these people. When you've spent a couple of weeks and months down in London,
you always think of Liverpool when you're from here. It's such a boss city and the people are so great. I couldn't wrap my head around you being a bad guy. You play a bit of a Scouse character, being the heel, until I watched you in the ring and I saw the reaction. And look, I lived in Sheffield for 4 years, and you just get your Scouse bastard, you get all the abuse, and I thought Scouser makes perfect sense to play a heel, because the wrestling game's all about heat. It's all about getting a reaction from the crowd, and ultimately, as much as it's it makes me uncomfortable to some extent. I'd love Scousers to be thought of as national treasures and national heroes. For that business, it feels like you've really hit upon something, because it's almost... We're almost stereotypical villains to people in some respect anyway.
In some respect, yeah. Like, the way I try to liken it, because I'm not trying to... I'm definitely not trying to drag the city through the dirt, no means at all. But the way I liken it is, it's just because of the way that I carry myself and the whole way that my act comes forwards, is it's an away game.
Yeah.
So I'm not getting jumped outside the venue.
Yeah.
In the same way that, like, would there be riots if our away fans got jumped outside the stadium?
Yeah.
When I'm not getting jumped, but whilst it's an away game, they're giving me stick,
yeah,
and I'm giving it back to them.
Yeah. You can see it when people are doing stand up if you're a Gibson, yeah, and they're doing the Scouse battle, but they're actually smiling when they do
that's
it, because they're bought into the whole story of it. They don't genuinely hate Scousers, but it's so when you consider the problem I always find with wrestling translating over to England is that some of the American stuff doesn't work over here as much, and that's a perfect example of something that's properly British. It's a British joke.
Yeah.
It's actually a joke that works in wrestling, but probably doesn't translate across the Atlantic, yeah, and that's probably what it needs. While we're here, we time this quite nicely. Outside the Shankly Gates, I mean, you've incorporated it. It's your finishing move. What was the inspiration? Was it just like, I just want to get something Liverpool related into there?
It's a mixture of a number of things, you know. Like, I wanted to get some Liverpool-centric stuff into my act. I've tried to reference Beatles as much as I can, reference Liverpool Football Club as much as I can. And then my actual moves are all sort of... I'm trying to think of the word for this and I can't think of it, but if you look at the moves, my finish is a submission.
Yeah.
Which you have to lock in.
Yeah.
So you lock the gates.
Well, is this just something to locking the Shankly gates?
Exactly.
You
know, yeah. And absolutely. I could have quite easily called it, you know, locking the gates outside my house in Liverpool, but then it doesn't have the same ring to it. So it's sort of bringing everything together.
Yeah.
It makes sense because you lock the gates, and then it makes sense because this is printed on the back of my trunks and it's the big deal. I have a move called the Helter Skelter, where you sort of swing them up, swing them round, drop them on the head, like a helter skelter. So
yeah,
well, there is a little bit more thought, which people don't quite give me credit for.
Well, no, I thought it, again, it was great, and that's the thing for me, is that watching you get involved with it gave me a greater connection to what you were doing, because it, you know, some people might see it as like it's an attempt at cashing, but it never feels that way. Yeah. It feels like a natural thing, and there's something that, again, I take great pride in hearing WWE commentators not just say he's locking in the Shankly Gate, but they reference the fact that it's from Anfield, yeah, Stadium and you're really using this thing. So it's not, you could just be Liverpool's number one and you could have nothing else and that would probably do it, but to have those connections, I think it just helps to solidify what
it gives it more layers as well. And like we were talking earlier before we started, you know, how it was quite surreal at the Albert Hall to be stood there in the ring and then have Triple H and Shawn Michaels come out, and 10-year-old me is just, his mind's just melting. But on top of that, after then watching it back, I also then got to hear Mauro Ranallo, one of the most world-famous and best commentators around that there's ever been. But he's not only talking about me and dropping my name and dropping my moves, he's also talking about Paisley and Shankly and talking about the history of Liverpool and then the history of the Beatles, and he's talking about Abbey Road, and it's nuts.
Yeah.
I'm quite happy, and like, I take a bit of pride there that I'm getting that in there. And then, like you say, you know, anyone that does watch in maybe can take it the wrong way. If you just look at the crowd, you'll see everyone smiling, waving the shoes around.
No, it's fantastic, absolutely fantastic. Well, let's stroll on, I guess. When you're in Liverpool, I think there's a clear path into certain areas and certain things. Football's just there. Yeah. Everyone in the city plays football. It's just it's like breathing. You pick up a football from a kid and you start playing, your mates play, and everyone's into it. You're red or you're blue, whatever. I think boxing's got a natural following. Yeah. I think Liverpool's a massive boxing city. We're now seeing that with mixed martial arts, you know, and that kind of stuff as well. But wrestling?
Football was easy. I used to play football all the time, played Sunday League and did all of that. But like, wrestling was something I at least wanted to try,
yeah,
and go for it. And I'm a moron anyway when it comes to like the internet and stuff. So I was desperately trying to find these wrestling schools. And if I just had even half a wits about me, yeah, I would have found one. There's one already in Birkenhead,
right,
which wouldn't have been too much of a stretch. Eventually, I found one in Runcorn, which again is not even that far, you know,
yeah,
by car, half an hour.
Sure.
But I was 15, so yeah, I didn't have that. I asked my dad if I could start training, And he said, in no uncertain terms, absolutely not.
Really?
He actually really came down on me hard because he did not want me to do wrestling. Why? So he said to me, no. I think it was just mainly, he didn't want me getting hurt, so he's always been quite protective in that way.
Has he seen Sunday League in Liverpool? You get more hurt.
I think that was it.
There was he's jumping off the top rope all the time.
He's balanced them though, hasn't he? He's gone dangerous, but I like football. Yeah. And then he's gone dangerous and rubbish. Don't want to do this. Forget wrestling, you're not doing it.
Yeah.
He told me I couldn't do it. But there was never anything that was going to stop me from at least trying it, especially when I found a school.
Yeah.
So I just snuck out the house for 2 years, and I went and did it without telling him. And I actually got a few bookings as well. So I was actually wrestling on really low-down shows. You're talking like working men's clubs. This was my generation when we started as well, though. Yeah. There were no big shows.
Yeah.
So we were, even the top show was like, oh, there's 200 people in. People would lose their minds. We were wrestling in working men's clubs in front of 30 or 40 people. Yeah. And I was doing these bookings, and then I was hiding my gear in my room, and I went from getting up at midday to lazing around the house and watching SmackDown and, you know, just going out and playing five-a-side with my mates.
Yeah.
And then suddenly every single Saturday I was getting up at 8 a.m. to go and catch 2 buses and a train to go and train wrestling. And my dad did pull me on. He said, you know, like, what's gotten into you? And I was, oh, Dad, I'm just there.
I've just gotten into drugs, Dad. And just leave me alone.
But not that wrestling thing. He'd be like, thank God.
I'm not around with a bad crowd, Dad. And just leave me be.
I actually told him, I'm just trying to make the most of my weekends, which is a lie from a 15-year-old lad.
Yeah.
And my dad just, okay,
yeah,
go on, have fun. And everyone used to joke with me saying, like, no, he knows. He knows. There's no way he doesn't know. And he didn't.
Wow.
Because I printed off a CV to get my first little part-time job. Talked about wrestling on it, left it at the side of my computer, and it hit the fan. My dad went mental, absolutely mental, kicked off, didn't talk to me for a couple of weeks. I still went training in those couple of weeks until he sat me down and said, I've had a think about this, and obviously you really want to do it, obviously it makes you happy.
Yeah.
I'm going to let you keep on doing it, but just promise me one thing, that you're not going to throw each other around. So I said, Dad, I promise. he's all right now.
I feel like you maybe didn't keep that promise quite.
No, I had to like ease him into it. I filmed me doing like a sort of wrist lock technique, and I showed him that, and he was like, oh, that's interesting. And then I showed him like a roll up, and now he has seen me, and now he's like my biggest supporter. He brags about me when he goes on dates. And
it's interesting because there's a lot of people who remember it from the 70s and the 80s, and let's be honest, it was a bit crap, and it was just whatever. Whereas we talk about, like, you know, the attitude era in WWF at the time had such a massive impact, and it feels like the British have picked it up and ran with it, and they've kind of got a very similar, it's got an American vibe to it, so it's familiar to people who grew up with WWF, WCW, but it's also, it doesn't feel like people doing a crap impression of American stuff. You've got your own organisation and stuff now, and WWE finally starting to recognise that the talent that exists in this country.
Yeah. One person couldn't have done this, one promoter couldn't have done this, but it was just a whole generation of like-minded lads who all just wanted the thing that we love to like get bigger. Yeah. And so it was everyone bouncing off each other, and like we went from the bloody 20, 30 people in a working men's club. Then we started getting these regular draws of 200, 300 people. Then people started moving into bigger venues. Now we've ran like Progress Wrestling down in London regularly, but they sell out in 2 or 3 minutes online, and they sell out the Electric Ballroom where Led Zeppelin used to play. I wrestled in Bids Club in Stoke on a rainy night in front of literally 5 people.
Yeah.
And then in September, I'm wrestling at Wembley for Progress. And it's just everything we ever wanted. It's
absolutely
unreal.
Incredible.
It's took me 12 years of just like awful things one after the other, and like sleeping in wrestling rings in buckets of sweat that we've already been in, like dive venues left, right and centre. We got abandoned in China. I've done a couple of tours of China. I actually love the country. I went back after being abandoned, which is a bit, I don't know why I did that. And I'm going back again at the end of August. But there's a group of us who went over on a tour. We were meant to be over there for 2 months. And then after 1 month, you have to get your visa renewed. And it was just getting up to this point, and the boss had clearly just bit off more than he could chew. He was trying not to pay us on time and just claiming China style, which is just their excuse for anything at all. Do you know, we say like, mate, can we sort something out here? There's a kid taking a dump in a bin over there. Can you sort this out while we're trying to get changed? He's like, no, it's China style. Can we get paid for the 10 shows that we've just done? Like, next week, China style. And then he just disappeared. He just turned his phone off, did a runner, left us all there. And luckily there was a Ho Ho Lun from Hong Kong was there, and he managed to get us home all right. But there was 2 days where it was just squeaky bum time. We were all at the hotel, just abandoned. And it's not even on the border to Hong Kong. We were in Chongqing, which is strictly Chinese speaking. No one speaks English, central China. So when people say to me, like, oh, that wrestling looks fun, well, it is, but it's not easy.
Yeah, yeah.
It's quite not easy.
So I guess, you know, when it comes around to it now, and even just, you know, the last few weeks, it feels like your career's just taken a massive, yeah, you know, a massive swing upwards. Obviously, they had the WWE NXT, the UK Championship was over here. It was a big deal. It was broadcast on the WWE Network. You went through that. You built up through the tournaments. You had the Royal Albert Hall wrestling, and they're making this massive deal about the history behind it. You know, like I say, I think sometimes they've played a little bit of, you know, the UK and Americans are terrible for this, by the way. Yeah. It's like, oh, the British, oh, great. You know what I mean? They do something that's a bit twee, whereas it felt like and this is what I think they've done with NXT really well, it felt real. It felt like a proper thing. So it felt like they gave you a real platform to perform.
Oh, it was unreal. And it's everything that our entire generation's been working for the last 12, 15 years. Everything that we ever wanted, and you know, you said it there yourself, it wasn't a watered down version or an Americanized version.
We're just loads of British flags, yeah, and like, you know, just like Tower Bridge and all that kind
I've
of
I've done
all
some stuff of... recently, and like I did the pilot for ITV, who by all accounts looks like they've actually learned from their mistakes.
Yeah.
But when I was there, it wasn't what I wanted to do. WWE is what I wanted to do. I did Five Star Wrestling, which was on Free Sports. That wasn't my end goal by any means. That was always a stepping stone to get to, yeah, WWE. Because those kind of products where they don't fully know what they're doing, they don't have the right brains in the back.
Yeah.
It's like Wayne's World. Noah's Arcade presents Wayne's World. And they pick up this gritty product,
yeah,
and then try to polish it, and they don't know what they're doing, and it looks rubbish, and yeah, no one wants to watch it. Whereas WWE stuck us in a British venue with British wrestlers, and in the team talks beforehand, they said, do what yous do. Don't change a thing. Go out and do what you do. Obviously, they give us little tweaks here and there of how to make things better, but it was purely guidance. And I main evented the Royal Albert Hall 2 nights on the bounce. I don't think there's actually ever been done in, yeah, wrestling. That's my little claim to fame now. That's what's going to get me a Wetherspoons in the future. but yeah, it was unreal. And on the night, I was so focused of just like, this is it. This is everything. This is 12 years. I'm in the WWE ring. It's going on the WWE Network. If this is it, it's got to be good. I go through to the final and win that. But I did. I beat British lads. So it's still, it hadn't quite sunk in yet what was happening. Even the WWE logos on the turnbuckle pads, it hadn't quite sunk in because I had to wrestle for about an hour that night,
yeah,
so I was just laser focused on just getting through it, and plus you're getting kicked in the head every 5 minutes, so I just had to get through it. And it was only at the end when we were celebrating and Johnny Saint, British wrestling legend, Shawn Michaels, Triple H, they came in and they stood in the ring with me, that I was looking round at the Albert Hall and everyone's booing, and then they give me a microphone as well and they said, just do your thing. So I sang Ole 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 just to get under the skin,
well,
a little bit, rub it in the face.
That was the clip, and it went pretty viral. You know, a couple in the aftermath from it, and it feels like there's a real crest of a wave at the moment around Liverpool. Liverpool are just on everyone's, you know, everyone's talking about the football club, and it just feels like the right time to get involved. Perfect Liverpool, by the way. Some kids bagging it on a moped. You know, there's a lot of stuff going on. It's stuff that, you know, we've been doing with Redmen and the rest. It does feel like it's almost the perfect time for there to be,
yeah,
a major Scottish wrestler to bring all those elements
in. It's good because it's not forced either. Like, it's all just come organically, do you know?
Well, it's not some American fella or a Manc lad or just a, you know, suddenly, yeah, putting on a Scouse accent. Because they could do that, let's be honest. You know,
oh, yeah,
you know,
and you've got the money to do it as well. But it does, it feels boss. Everyone's coming up to me and like, every time we get someone like Klopp at the club, every time one of these big personalities comes across, it just helps me. And I like to think that when I'm doing my stuff, that brings more eyes on other things. And it's just awesome, isn't it? I've got no other words for it. I just
absolutely
love it.
Absolutely amazing. With, yeah, regards to your moves, you go into it and you're thinking like, well, I want to be a submission guy, so I'm going to have a submission finisher. I need a move that's going to get me to that, or... Yeah, what's the mindset behind it? It's just I just do moves that I like.
Yeah, I think over the years it's changed so much. When I first got in, I was convinced. I was like, well, I'm going to be a high flyer. I'm going to be doing so many flips.
Surely everyone gets into wrestling thinking I'm going to be the next.
I was like, Jeff Hardy is going to have to move over because that's going to be me. I had long blonde hair at the time. And that was going to be me until I realised I can't do flips.
Yeah,
I just physically can't do them. So I think there's so many things that go into it. One of them is just knowing who you are.
Yeah.
And then the other thing was when I actually started going, I really took to technical wrestling. It was just what naturally became my strength.
Yeah.
I really took to it. I enjoyed doing it. I enjoyed being aggressive. So that came really naturally. And so that started flowing into it. And then you've got to be entertaining. So you've still got to have moves that look good.
You've got to have a style that fits. And I guess you probably... Yeah. It's like anything. When you take to the stage, I imagine, like stand-up comedy... You work on stuff and you see what fits and you see what gets the biggest reaction from the crowd, and you almost hone your you're honing your character, you're honing your arsenal around that basically.
So over the years I've chopped and changed certain things, certain stuff that just wasn't getting over with the crowd, stuff that people didn't bite to. And then the Ticket to Ride is just the way I've branded it now, because I use my knees quite a lot.
Yeah.
It's just something that came natural. I'm quite long but big.
Yeah.
So whenever I jump onto someone, they don't really have a choice but to come with me.
Yeah.
And then I started just hitting it from all different areas. So then I just said, I've told the commentators, I've told anyone, like the Ticket to Ride is when both of my knees get someone. And that is the thing. So I do it, like you said, I do it from a tombstone, like north, south, throw them up, trip them when they're on the second rope so that they split, pull them out there. I come off the second rope, I come from standing. That's my move that I can just call upon at any time in a match. It doesn't matter where we are, I can get someone with that. But then if I've got enough time, it'll be the Helter Skelter. It's a little bit of a slower setup, but then the payoff's much bigger.
Yeah.
And then the sub is something that I robbed from Nigel McGuinness, who now does commentary for WWE. He was a massive influence when I started finding myself.
Yeah.
So when I started realising that I was good at technical wrestling, when I started realising I was good at beating people up, it was around the same time that Nigel McGuinness was riding high in Ring of Honor.
Yeah.
And I saw Nigel McGuinness doing the exact things that I was doing. He was beating people up. He was doing his submission wrestling. Then when it came to his retirement tour, I wrestled him on his retirement tour.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, in Widnes, of all places, in a tiny building. I was wrestling like one of my heroes. And he was just great. He gave me so much advice and everything that I took the submission from that match. Yeah. I wasn't doing it up until that match. And then after I wrestled him since he was retiring, I thought, like, I'm gonna carry this on.
Yeah.
I'm going to take his move so that it doesn't die. And I always reference it in things like this. But then, obviously, for my own thing, I've rebranded it as the Shankly Gates.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. Well, it's cool. I love the evolution because, I mean, inevitably, you know, big guy, black trunks, bald head. You know, there's going to be inevitable, like, Stone Cold comparisons, I reckon. And I think the fact that you go on about having the early days with the blonde, with the blonde hair and stuff like that.
Like Stunning Steve.
Exactly, you know. So, what in terms of your idols, you know, of the American wrestlers, of the old school stuff, who were the guys, you know, obviously you mentioned Jeff Hardy there already. Was it the High Flyers or...?
It was a mixture of High Flyers and big characters. So my very first favourite wrestler was actually Billy Gunn.
Really?
Yeah, it's just something about, he was just large in life, he's part of DX, but he was a bit of an underdog within DX, and he was just a big character, and I liked him, I liked his stuff. Rob Van Dam,
of course,
because again, he's a big character, who loves Liverpool,
really,
ironically enough, yeah.
Wow.
I wrestled him recently, and he was on one of the tours, and we did Liverpool, Manchester, Sheffield, Belfast, and he was going out on a night out with his missus after every show, and he pulled me in Belfast. And he was like, "You're from Liverpool, aren't you, mate?" I was like, "You won't give it away." And he was like, "Oh man, I love Liverpool. I love it." He was talking about, he was actually in Concert Square, of all places.
Amazing. Yeah.
He was sat out in the sun in Concert Square.
Amazing.
And he was just putting over doing the nightlife.
Doing the Van Damminator with the chairs from Modo.
So my favourite three when I was a kid was Van Damme, Hardy, Billy Gunn. I wrestled Billy Gunn in London about 4 years ago. I wrestled Rob Van Dam within the last 12 months.
You wrestled Rey Mysterio as well?
Rey Mysterio. Yeah. So the one...
Is he literally this big?
Do you know what? He's the best. He's just the best. The best high flyer there's ever been. Like, you can feel the quality when you're in there. The way that he moves around, he's like, it's unbelievable. And like, especially how long he's been doing it, you could almost forgive him if he would have showed up and phoned it in.
Yeah.
And then he just didn't. He showed up every single night to work. I can't say enough nice things about Rey Mysterio. He's the best.
Absolutely amazing.
But like left out of my big three when I was a kid to sort of tick it off and just come full circle. I need to wrestle Jeff Hardy and he's back where he belongs in WWE and now I'm on the ladder. So That's what I'm aiming for.
It all exists within possibility. So what's really cool is obviously you've been through the UK tournament. You got to put yourself across there. Put yourself across there really well as well. Obviously didn't come out with the belt, but NXT UK are on tour as well. That you're coming to Liverpool.
Yeah, it's a marathon, not a sprint. So I won the tournament night one. That was three matches on the same night. Pete had a six-man tag. Do you know what I mean? Like, I'm not making excuses, but I'm just saying there will be a rematch at some point if I have even half of my own way.
Yeah.
So the next shows are July 28th and 29th.
Yeah.
Cambridge Corn Exchange. Then they'll be heading to Birmingham in August. That's the 25th, 26th. Plymouth Pavilions, which I've wrestled at before, and that's a really, really good venue.
Yeah.
That's October 13th, 14th, and then the big one. I don't know how this has happened. I don't know who's in the back putting these things together, but the final date of the first set of tapings is in Liverpool Olympia, and that's November 24th, 25th.
It's mad, isn't it? Because you know you're playing a heel, you're playing the villain, and then look, there's just no way that Liverpool's going to have you as the bad guy when you're wrestling in the Olympia.
I think half the city might.
Actually, it's a good point.
But when I was putting the whole thing together anyway, it was never as... Don't get me wrong, I am the villain. Yeah. I am a villain, but in a different way.
Yeah.
Not in a way that's necessarily come before you. That comes down to my training and the people that have spoke to me. They said, you know, you can follow in someone else's footsteps and try to be the next so-and-so, or follow that path that everyone walks on. Like, every wrestler and the dog goes to Japan.
Yeah.
But they told me, go where no one else goes and do your own thing. So when everyone else was going to Japan, I went to China. When everyone else was trying to be a good guy or a villain, I thought, no, I'm going to be Scouse. I'm just going to do that. And when I'm away, I'll get booed because it's an away game. And when I'm at home, I'll get cheered because I'm at home. So that's kind of how I treat it. And by the way this is going, and with the little things that I've got in the back of my head and what I want to do, the end of the tour is at Liverpool. So anyone in the area needs to be at the Olympia if it's not already sold out, because I know it's selling fast.
Actually, the thing I love is that actually you've brought it in there. You're putting it out there for me to, as a wrestling fan, to go on the WWE Network, and just something where, for me, a lot of it is nostalgia. I go back there and I watch the old school stuff. I watch the Monday Night Wars, and then you're watching this brand new stuff. There's a local lad on there, and the commentators are not referencing Liverpool in this like really twee way that I think happens a lot of times when, you know, Americans try to reference our culture. It's just matter of fact.
Yeah.
There's the Shankly Gates. It's the move. This is where they come from. It's about Anfield Stadium. It's about Liverpool Football Club. It's about the city of Liverpool. Yeah.
I run a training school now in McGull, Fighting Spirit Wrestling, which is like, my dad's from McGull, so I opened it up by there. Got an excuse to go and see him now. But when we teach, when I was first coming up, everyone used to tell me, like, if you really want to know what wrestling is, but you can't sort of get your head around it, then watch Rocky.
Yeah.
Because Rocky is, that's essentially what wrestling is, isn't it? It's just this big story, larger than life characters, good versus evil,
yeah,
and the underdog fighting up through. And I was taught that from an early stage, that if ever you want to know how to do it right, just watch Rocky. Watch him get battered, watch him refuse to give up, watch him fight through everything and come back up. But now when we teach a fighting spirit, I don't talk about Rocky anymore. One, because I call the shots, so I get to say whatever I want to say. But I tell them to go and watch Istanbul. So if ever you need to see, like, Steven Gerrard could walk into pro wrestling any day of the week. And if ever he wants to, just, you can come with me. You can be my manager, or just like a little wrestling caddy or something.
It doesn't work out at Rangers. Yeah. Stevie's got a career.
If you somehow spend your millions and millions of pounds and you want to get into wrestling. No, because like that's, you can see it in all
it's
different walks of life.
It's
a
scripted story that wasn't scripted.
No. And then the one thing that good wrestlers have is fire. And when you're watching, like, when the first goal on the comeback goes in and Gerrard's running down the pitch, firing everyone up, that's all I see in my head whenever I have to pull myself off the mat. I just see Gerrard, so.
Absolutely amazing, mate. So, it's been a mad year. The most recent thing, of course, is the UK Championship. But what have you got? What's coming up next?
In the short term, we've got a lot of the WWE UK shows are coming up. So, like I say, July, we're in Cambridge. August, we're in Birmingham. October, Plymouth. November, Liverpool. Tied in with all of that, I've got a three-week tour of the States with Progress, where we're getting about. I'm going back over to China. But for a more specific question, which I'm sure is what you actually meant.
Tell me ambitions.
Short term is to win the UK title from Pete Dunne. Pete's carried that belt for God knows how many months now. It's actually over a year. And he's done a great job carrying it. He's put the scene on the map, but now I want to take that and I want to run with it and I want to take it further.
Yeah.
My short-term goal is to take the UK title off Pete Dunne. My long-term goal is to be the first British-born heavyweight champion in WWE. And I'm going to do it all with a live bird on my kecks.
Pretty decent set of ambitions, really, isn't it? What are we going to be doing for the rest of the year? Not that exciting, like you mean, but listen, mate, absolutely incredible.
No, thanks for having us.
Yeah, and all the best. And obviously, get involved if you can. Follow Zach on Twitter and what have you, and obviously wait and watch as a Scouser dominates world wrestling.
Beatles, music, Liverpool football. I'm hoping my name's up there with the other two.
That'd be amazing. Class, mate.